Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the channel. Today, we're going to be discussing an article from Bounding Into Comics, Mr. John F. Trent, about superheroes being, quote unquote, and I hate using this word, problematic. Yes, this is based off of an article from Time Magazine and likened superheroes to cops with capes. Yes, absurdity abound. And I just wanted to let you all know before we do the thing that I will be off for a few days. I'll have some releases set from now until probably Sunday. You'll get a couple more videos out of me, but we'll be back to normal on Monday with the podcast, just as you come to expect. And now I can say the phrase, monkeys, roll the footage. All right, we're ready to get into this article from yesterday. John F. Trent, Bounding Into Comics. Time Magazine declares superheroes a problem because they star, quote, straight white men, which we all know right off the bat is a lie. I'm only going to read a couple paragraphs of this article, then I'm going to kind of give you my thoughts as we work our way through. Just read the header here. Time Magazine and self-described feminism writer Eliana Doctorman recently declaring that superheroes are a problem, specifically taking issue with a number of superheroes' gender, race, and sexuality. Well, Miss Eliana Doctorman, that in itself is a form of discrimination, is it not? If Doctorman's name sounds familiar, she was part of a chorus of voices that attacked Marvel Comics for publishing Milo Manara's Spider-Woman number one variant cover back in 2014.
Damn, boy, he's thick, boy, that's a thick-ass boy, damn.
In her article titled, We're Reexamining How We Portray Cops on Screen, It's Time to Talk About Superheroes, she declares that superheroes are a problem because they are cops with capes. Not to get too deep down this rabbit hole, but I really have a hard time villainizing police officers, even though I acknowledge that there are a lot of bad ones. There are, because there are some of them that use that badge and that gun as a symbol of power instead of peace, which therein lies the problem. But those individuals have issues before they became police officers. And then they're exacerbated by that sense of power. And that happens to anybody with that amount of power. But to say that superheroes are problematic because they're cops with capes, does she not understand that this is escapist entertainment at its core, is what I want to know. It's really these people that make these straw man arguments and then sit back on their faux moral high ground and want to, you know, preach down from the mountaintop to the rest of us supposed plebs that we don't know what's best for us. You'll tell us. From your mountaintop, where none of us can ever go to your mountaintop, but you'll tell us from there, because even though we're all equal, you're still better than us. Doesn't make much sense, does it? Doctorman begins her article by implying there is something wrong with police officers and notes the knee-jerk reaction in Hollywood to violent BLM rioters and looters who are demanding police forces across the country be defunded and dismantled.
Shut the fuck up, Donnie. Shut the fuck up, Donnie.
She then writes, but as we engage in this long overdue conversation about law enforcement, it's high time we also talk about the most popular characters in film, the ones who decide the parameters of justice and often enact them with violence, superheroes. She goes on to cite the issues that she has with superheroes. With a few notable exceptions, more on that later, most superhero stories star straight white men who either function as an extension of a broken U.S. justice system or as vigilantes without any checks on their powers. Doctorman continues, usually they have some sort of tentative relationship with the government. The Avengers work for the secret agency of S.H.I.E.L.D. No, they don't. Batman takes orders from the Gotham Police Commissioner Gordon. No, he doesn't.
Every word of what you just said was wrong.
Even the villainous members of the Suicide Squad execute government orders in exchange for commuted prison sentences. That's the only point she gets correct. As an aside, the Avengers might have initially operated under S.H.I.E.L.D. in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. They no longer do after the events of Captain America: The Winter Soldier, which exposed that Hydra had infiltrated and corrupted the government agency. Winter Soldier is my favorite MCU movie, and if you took that out of the MCU and stood it alone, it's a great movie. So Doctorman really has made a bunch of factual errors in this, and I'll link the article so you can read it yourself. I just kind of want to highlight a few points here. Despite her factual errors, Doctorman continues to cite her grievances with superheroes, and even when superheroes function outside the justice system, they're sometimes idolized by police because they're able to skirt the law to, quote, get the job done. And then she then goes on, of course, to take issue with the police and military, some of them using the Punisher logo, and there's a whole paragraph and a panel about that. I would just say that the Punisher was created in 1974. It's a product of its time. Don't be a twat. Just simply that. Don't be a twat. Really. I mean, what? Why? Why? Why can't we just have escapist entertainment? Why can't we have it? What is wrong with you?
Why are you the way that you are? I hate so much about the things that you choose to be.
Another grievance she has with superheroes is they have no accountability. You know, she says the Punisher is representative of a larger problem in superhero narratives. Batman ignores orders and goes rogue. There's no oversight committee to assess whether Bruce Wayne's biases influence who he brings to justice and how. She had superheroes like Iron Man occasionally feel guilt about casualties they inflict. They ultimately empower themselves again and again to draw those moral lines. It's a fictional world. There's no superheroes in real life. You know, it doesn't work like that. So in this fictional world, they don't have to take on all these issues. You understand what I'm saying? It doesn't have to be a documentary, a docudrama about the current life, but translated into a superhero film. We can still have entertainment that's pure escapism without all this. And it can still have a little bit of real world issues in it. Of course they can. But it doesn't have to be the main focal point of a movie that's meant to be a fun escapist, you know, 2 hours away from your normal everyday life, all the problems and issues. That's what this is. And that's what the problem is with these people, is they don't understand that. Doctorman then doubled down on her issues with superheroes being about race, gender, sexuality. She writes, what's more, given the creators and stars, these have been historically white men. And of course, she goes on with the white man bad argument. And then she said they don't take on systemic racism, sexism, homophobia, transphobia, and other forms of bigotry embedded in the justice system.
Social justice, 1, 2, 3. Woo, woo. I wanna be PC. Woo, woo. It's just the way to be for me and you.
Again, I go back to my escapist entertainment. They make up enough problems, and some of these are on a cosmic level. So you're telling me that in multiple worlds across the galaxy, they have to be represented too?
Sure, Jan.
The Kree and the... This is such a ridiculous even analogy, I can't even make it with a straight face. I mean, seriously though, really, like, you're telling me that the Skrulls and the Kree have to get along perfectly? No. So you're telling me that there has to be, like, tension in, say, the Skrull community because, well, I guess the Skrulls can change into whoever. Oh, see, here comes the argument that the Skrulls are already transgender because they can imitate anybody, right? But what chromosome are they born with? I don't know. See, it doesn't matter because they're not human. It doesn't matter. You want representation? There it is. She goes on to then, of course, praise Black Panther, which I do like Black Panther, but I do acknowledge the third act of the movie fell apart with the writing with Killmonger just wasn't the best. And the CGI was horrible. And she, of course, goes on to applaud Miles Morales. I have no issue with Miles Morales. I really loved Into the Spider-Verse. I thought it was a super fun movie. Of course, praises Watchmen. I haven't seen the Watchmen movie since it came out. It's a vague memory to me. I never read the graphic novels, nor have I watched the show, nor will I watch the show. From the reviews that I trust, it's not something that would interest me, nor do I have any interest in it. And she, of course, concludes with the normal Hollywood talking points. If Hollywood is to do better in telling these stories, more creatives of color need to be given power. White people need to use their capital to, you know, prop up these people of color in their storytelling and basically just step aside and let them tell the stories, but be an ally is what she's alluding to. And I have no problem with, you know, giving a voice to creators of all backgrounds, regardless of any ethnicity. It doesn't matter. Who can tell the best story and captivate the audience the most is the ultimate winner here. That's who wins, because then the fans win. The audience wins. The people who pay money for this win. You see what I'm saying? You don't get to just make entertainment for your elite Hollywood friends and all these other weirdos who subscribe to this extreme ideology and then pat yourselves on the back and say, look what I did, and then get mad when nobody buys it. Marvel Comics are a perfect example of that. What do you guys think? Let me know in the comments below, ladies and gentlemen. I'm a bit fired up, but this is something I'm quite passionate about. Let me know what you think. Love you guys. Thanks for subscribing. Please, if you haven't yet, hit that subscribe button. Turn the bell on for notifications so you know every time we upload a new video or have a live stream. Let's take it home. Catch you guys later. Here's where you can find us all across social media at TB2BR on Instagram, the Place to Be Reviews page on Facebook, the official Place to Be Reviews fan page, that's our private group, at the Place to Be RE1, at N80P on Twitter, past podcast available on Anchor, iTunes, and Spotify, and now the Place to Be Reviews on Discord. You can also email us if you're old fashioned, okay, boomer, at theplacetobereviews@mail.com, the world's best mail. Thank you very much. Also, on the way out, don't forget to bitch slap that like button. Do me that big solid, would ya? Yeah, I think you can do that. Also, hail the Phantom Menace. Hail to thee, my subscribers. If you haven't subscribed yet, please consider doing so. Help us grow the channel. Hail the Fandom Collective, a group which we are proud members of now. We'll be working with them on a lot of collaborations in the near future. And I'd like to personally thank you all for joining the Place to Be Reviews. That's right, I'm Itepa Kuyan of the Place to Be Reviews right here with all yous. Remember, if I don't see you, have a great day and a pleasant tomorrow.